Very good, very good, very good. I am excited to introduce you to our speaker for today. His name is Rudy. Everybody say Rudy.
Rudy.
Mr. Rudy Hagood is a very dear friend of mine. He and I met several years ago. I was actually serving as an elder at a church in Simi Valley, and Rudy came on board as one of our pastors there, and immediately we just became friends. We have a common passion. One, we love some Jesus. This man loves some Jesus. We also have a passion for reaching men, reaching dads, on how to be better husbands and dads and just men overall. And we both absolutely love it. And I know some of you might not feel this way all the time when I talk to you, but we love kids, right? And I know it doesn't feel that way when I'm coming down on you sometimes, but we absolutely love you. Rudy is now the lead pastor at University Christ Church, or Christian Church, University Christian Church out in Los Angeles. He's taking a little drive to be here with us today, and you're gonna notice something about him. He's like all the other speakers that I brought in today. He's just a little bit smaller than I am. I like to be the big guy in the room, so you know, give it up for Mr. Rudy Hagood as he brings the message today. See, I told you he's a small guy.
Whoa, wow. Oaks Christian, huh? Look at y'all. Wow, okay. Wow, all right. God has a calling on your life. And I know you're a middle schooler, but I'm telling you right now, at this time, not for later, not for tomorrow, but right now, God has a calling on your life. And I want to ask you a question. Have you been running from the call of God? Has God been calling and you've been sending him to voicemail? Have you been ignoring the whisper? Have you been silencing the ringer? Believer, non-believer, God has a plan for you, and today I'm here because God is calling you to step into your destiny. There are some things I may not know. There are some places I cannot go, but I am sure of this one thing. My God is real, for I can feel him in my soul. There are some things I may I know. There are some places I cannot go, but I am sure of this one thing. Yes, my God is real, for I can feel him in my soul. Yes, my God is real. He's so real in my soul. Don't you know God is real? For he has washed and he made me whole. Lord, your love for me, it's just like pure gold. Don't you know God is real? For I can feel him in my soul. I might not know a lot, but I know that my God is real. And that God that I just sang about, that God has a call on your life. So today, I take for a title, Missed Call, when God is on your voicemail. Voicemails are those events that occur when one doesn't answer the call. You know what I'm talking about, right? All of y'all got smartphones, right? Everybody has a smartphone, and you know when you get that call and it's from that person, and you see the red dot and the green dot, and you know you ain't doing nothing, but you press the red button and send them the voicemail. You know, yeah. Oh, come on now, y'all know what I'm talking about. You know, come on. You all right? Look. All right, look. I grew up out here, but my family's from Alabama, and down south we talk back to one another.
Amen.
All right, so if I'm talking, you can talk back. Y'all with me?
Yeah.
All right, so yeah, you know what I'm talking about, right?
Yeah.
All right. My mom loves to leave me voicemails. My mom will call me, and I don't get to see my mom all the time, and I get all excited, and she calls me, and I'm like, hey, Ma. Like I said, I'm from Birmingham. I don't say mom or mother. I say Ma. Hey, Ma. And then my mom says something like, oh, I didn't want to talk to you. I wanted to leave you a voicemail. Okay. And then I hang up, and she calls back. And my mom says things like, son, don't grow weary in well-doing. She says things like, son, since you were 10 years old, God has had a call on your life. My mom likes to leave me voicemails to redirect me, to point me where that I should be going. I used to be a program director at a group home, which meant I was on call. Anyone know anything about being on call? If there's anyone's parents are doctors and they're on call, they might be at home, but the phone could ring, and in any moment they might have to stop what they're doing and go and respond because they are on call. Being a Christian is being on call. No matter what's going on in your life, no matter where you are, God might move, and when he calls, he expects you to answer. See, when God says go, then we gotta go. God sends voicemails to reroute our life back to his plan. Today's message is this. The best way to find yourself is to lose yourself in who he says you are, not in who you think you are. Avoiding God's call is avoiding your ordained and divine destiny. Oaks, Christian, arise and go. We're going to be in the book of Jonah. You guys have Bibles? You guys have Bibles? You got phones? Can you Bible apps? Oh, the teachers take y'all phones from y'all? Life is hard, huh? Life is hard. All right. So I'm by myself. All right. So I'm going to start Jonah chapter 1. So just track with me with the story, and let's see what God has to say to us this morning. Verse 1. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it, for their evil has come up before me. But Jonah rose to flee to Tarshish. From the presence of the Lord, he went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish. He paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish, away from the presence of the Lord. The reason God was sending Jonah to preach was to against Nineveh, to call them into judgment, to judge that city. And Jonah didn't want to go. It wasn't because he didn't want to be mean to Nineveh. It wasn't because he liked them so much that he didn't want to judge them. It was that he didn't like them, and he knew that if he judged them and called them to what God had called them to, that God had a big heart and God would change his mind and bless them and help them. All right, let me bring this to y'all. Who's your rival?
Celtics.
UCLA. Oaks Christian plays against UCLA?
West Lake.
All right. Now, when Westlake is playing, do you guys want them to win?
No.
You mean you guys don't go to Westlake and try to beautify their campus?
You got to try to destroy them, right? They are your enemy. Well, for Jonah, Nineveh was Westlake, but worse. See, Nineveh was known for atrocities and war crimes and being evil people. And Nineveh had done horrific things to Jonah's people, the children of God. Matter of fact, they would flay people. Meaning, they would skin people alive. Jonah didn't like the Ninevites. And Jonah didn't want to go there and give them an opportunity for God to speak into their life. They were known for atrocities and horrible activities, but God had called Jonah to go to Nineveh, and Jonah ran to the city of Tarshish. God often says go, and we often say no. Let me speed along. Verse 4, but the Lord hurled a great wind upon the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship threatened to break up. Then the mariners were afraid, and each cried out to his God, and they hurled the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten it for them. But Jonah had gone down into the inner parts of the ship and had lain down and was fast asleep. So the captain came and said to him, what do you mean, you sleeper? Arise, call out to your God. Perhaps the God will give a thought to us that we may not perish. So Jonah was called to Nineveh, and Jonah didn't like those people. So Jonah decided, I'm gonna commandeer a boat. I'm gonna go buy a boat. Commandeer means I'm gonna take ownership. I'm gonna rent out the time. I'm gonna rent out the boat. I'm gonna rent out the sailors. All this is for me so that I can get away. I'm gonna go to Tarshish to get away from the call that God has on my life. And then they're on this boat, and there's a storm happening, and the people are like, what's going on? The mariners, these are sailors. These are professional sailors. They don't get scared at small storms. So this storm is shaking the boat, and Jonah is in the bottom of the boat sleeping. Jonah was snoring, completely oblivious to the storm. Disobedience to God is draining. Jonah was in the bottom of the boat, worn out. And I understand Jonah because my son plays basketball, and we were in Vegas at a basketball tournament, and we got this room, and we thought it had two rooms, but it only had one. So my son was in the room with me and my wife, and then we all go to sleep, and I wake up in the morning, and my son is sitting in this little chair. My son is 6'6", and he's sitting in this little chair, and I'm like, what happened? And he comes in the room, and he says, Mom, how do you do it? Because I could snore, boy. Woo. I could go. All right. So I understand, Jonah. But disobedience is draining. Did you also notice that the mariners, because of Jonah's disobedience, were in danger for their life? Disobedience is not an individual sport. When you don't respond to the call of God, it impacts those around you. Often others pay when we fail to respond to the call. But God sends storms. Did you notice that God hurled the storm? God caused the storm. See, storms are just God's voicemail saying, God, that I have a call on your life. Don't grow weary in well-doing. That's something, when you have trouble and difficulty in your life, God is moving and trying to get you redirected and pointed back to where he wants you to be. Sometimes a storm is just a new voicemail. See, while you sleep undisturbed, your sleep disturbs others. Verse 7. And they said to one another, let us cast lots that we may know on whose account this evil has come upon us. So they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. Then they said to him, tell us on whose account this evil has come upon us. What is your occupation, and where do you come from? What is your country, and of what people are you? They're trying to figure this out. Verse 9, and he said to them, I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land. Then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, what is this that you have done? For the men knew that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord, because he had told them. I want you guys to notice something. This is a poem, and this poem that it's what's called a chiastic structure. I'm not gonna get into that, but verse 9 is the climax of this poem, which tells us the point, and the point is this. When he says, I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land, what God is revealing to us is this. See, failure to respond to your call is an identity issue. When you don't know who you are, you don't know how to act. Instead of saying, I don't know my calling, a better statement is, I don't know who I am. See, Jonah was the preacher who wouldn't preach. Jonah was the was that wouldn't. Jonah was, but he wouldn't. Sometimes I is, but I isn't. I know some of y'all thinking that's bad English, but it's good preaching.
Amen.
See, sometimes we know what we should be doing, but we're not responding to the call that God has on our life. And we, like Jonah, we run and we commandeer a boat. We go and put ourselves in a situation to flee from God. And all that does is causes pain and trouble on others when God wants to use us to redeem someone else. And Jonah, although he was living like he wasn't, even though we are, we often live like we are not. Verse 11, then they said to him, what shall we do to you that the sea may quiet down for us? For the sea grew more and more tempestuous. He said to them, pick me up and hurl me into the sea. Then the sea will quiet down for you, for I know it is because of me that this great tempest has come upon you. Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to get back to dry land, but they could not, for the sea grew more and more tempestuous against them. Therefore, they called out to the Lord, O Lord, let us not perish for this man's life, and lay not on us innocent blood, for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you. So they picked up Jonah and hurled him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows. See, sometimes when you live on mission, you won't like where you end up. Sometimes God is calling you into a place that's uncomfortable for you. See, sometimes you see that kid being bullied, and you know if you say something, then those bullies, even if they don't bully you, they're gonna look at you in a different way, and you don't want that. But when you have a calling on your life, you gotta go anyway, because when God says go, you gotta go. I want you to notice something. Jonah, a Hebrew, he's a man who feared God. He's running from God. But when these men realized God wanted Jonah into this ocean, they went out the boat, the men hurled Jonah out into the ocean, and Jonah was swallowed by this whale. And the men who didn't know God responded to God's call better than the men who knew God. Don't allow the uncalled to answer your call. Let me wrap this up. Verse 17, and the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. I called out to the Lord of my distress, and he answered me out of the belly of Sheol. I cried, and you heard my voice. Jonah is in the belly in Sheol, in this Sheol is a grave or in this most difficult place. And out of struggle and difficult, Jonah's ministry eventually was fulfilled. Out of struggle and difficulty, Jesus' ministry was fulfilled. In our most difficult situations, God is fulfilling our destiny. But I want you to notice God's reaction to Jonah, right? Jonah, God calls Jonah to go to Nineveh, and Jonah runs. Jonah goes down and he's sleeping at the bottom of the boat, and the storm comes, and Jonah is trying not to say anything, but God is continually calling him. He's calling him and calling him, and Jonah, and every time God calls, Jonah looks at his phone and presses the red button. He presses the red button. But Jonah, when he was in the belly of the whale, he's in his most desperate place, and finally he calls out to God. He cries out to God, and God says, "Hello." One call and God responds. One chance to say, "God, be there. God, save me," and God responds. We press the red button, but God always presses the green button.
Amen.
It's like when I was a kid, I would see my room was dirty, and I would walk right on by. I knew what my mama wanted me to do. God didn't need Jonah. Sometimes we act like God needs us. God could have sent someone else. God could have said, "Okay, you don't want this blessing, I'll call someone else to do it." God didn't need Jonah. I want you to know something. God is not just concerned with the mission. He's also concerned with the messenger. God doesn't just use people to complete tasks, but God uses tasks to complete people. God is not only concerned with the mission, he's concerned with the missionary, with the person. He's trying to do something in your life. Each time you say no when God is calling you, it's not going to go away. God's going to just keep sending storms, so you might as well say, "Hello." The best way to find yourself is to lose yourself in who he says you are, not in who you think you are. Avoiding God's call is avoiding your ordained and divine destiny. Oaks Christian, arise and go.
Did that speak to you a little bit? I hope you guys have enjoyed the various speakers that I've been fortunate to bring in and see all the different expressions of how people follow the Lord and all those different messages that actually speak to our heart. Sometimes we get in a little box and we think that God only speaks in a certain way, but when other people come and give their various perspectives, it really opens up that God is for us, but sometimes we got to push that green button. Say yes. With that said, got a couple announcements and then we're going to dismiss, okay? The first thing I want to do here is I want to bring up a young man, Dashiell Derrickson. Where you at, Dashiell? Yeah, Dashiell, come on down. Price is right for you today. It just so happens that tomorrow we're going to have a new principal on campus. Principal for the day, Principal Dashiell Derrickson. And our principal for the day tomorrow has an announcement for y'all. So I'm gonna let him give it to you. Here you go.
What's up, guys? All right, so tomorrow you're all gonna get free dress. So yeah. Is that it? Oh, seventh grade, I mean, sorry. My bad. Ha, all right. So like just those guys.
Hey, a good principal always reserves his right to change his mind. So it's just seventh grade, right?
Yeah.
All right, give it up for Dashiell. Seventh grade, you can boo all you want. He's a large and in charge. All right. So one more announcement. So Dashiell, he's gonna have a great day tomorrow. He is the principal in charge tomorrow. Seventh grade has free dress, so don't forget that. Don't y'all come in free dress thinking, oh, I heard him wrong. I thought he said, no, it's not going to work. Okay? Second announcement. Next Wednesday at 5B lunch. Now, I know this isn't for everybody because some of you have 5A, but at 5B lunch, we are going to have our first FCA Bible study huddle. If you are not in Bible or you are in Bible and you are on a 5B lunch and you want to come hang out, get some pizza, get some drinks, and be a part of just getting together once a week, having about a 20-minute little Bible study, talking about some stuff, especially from an athletic perspective, but you don't have to be an athlete. You can come next Wednesday. We're going to have announcements in the pods. We want to do this because especially in eighth grade, we only have Bible one semester. So some of you are not in Bible anymore. So we want to at least create some space once a week to come and engage with the Word of God. And so if you want to do that, we'll have the announcements up. So I just wanted to plant that seed. All right. Mrs. Heinbuck has a message for you. Yes. One more announcement on the father-daughter dance. If you and your daddy are going to go, it is this Saturday. Remember, you got to get signed up. Talk to your dad. You guys can get signed up for that. It's a great thing, you guys. Ladies, go to that with your daddy. Now, here's how we're going to close. It's 10:01. We got to be out of here in about 4 minutes. I would like all of you to stand. Everybody stand. I'm going to ask Mr. Rudy to come back up. And I'm going to ask Mr. Root. Now, I've always talked about our rhythm with clapping. We just got to. We got some work. But I'm going to ask Mr. Rudy to come up and sing his song one more time. But I'm going to ask him to lead you, right? Right? Can you do that, Mr. Rudy? I would love for you one more time. If you do an abbreviated version, right? Sing one more time for us and then pray for us and send us out. Mr. Rudy.
Oh, man. All right, here we go. There are some things I may not know. There are some places I cannot go. But I am sure. Him in my soul. Yes, my God is real. He is real in my soul. Don't you know God is real? For he has washed and he made me whole. Lord, your love for me is just like pure gold. You know God is real, for I can feel Him in my soul. Blessed Father, we thank you for who you are. We thank you, God, for loving us. God, I thank you, Lord, for this church, for this school, for this institution. I thank you, God, for their heart for kids, for the community. God, sometimes when we are young, we think, God, life is waiting for us, but life is right now. Impart on these kids that they are not the future, but they are the right now. That there's work that you want them to do, that you want them to express the glory of God right now. God, will you inspire them to do great things, God, in this moment? Not to wait, to live for you. To love you, God, and to love people, to bless people. God, will you move on the hearts of all these middle schoolers? Will you surround them and protect them? God, we ask this in the name of your blessed Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 Have a good one, you guys.